today is going to be about planar graphs. Graphs that can be embedded in the plane.
Okay, so what's a graph and what's a plane and what's embedding?
I'll tell you all about that. So a graph, it consists of a bunch of points that we call vertices. And then some pairs of vertices are joined by a line that we call an edge, and like this. And some pairs of vertices don't have anything between them. So for example, this is a graph. This is also a graph called a house.
You actually call that a house?
We actually call that a house, yes. We also, its official name is P5 complement. Its nickname is a house.
Professor, when I was at school, a graph to me had like an X and a Y axis and a line and things like that. But this is not what that looked like.
Completely unrelated. It's just an unfortunate overloading of a word. Okay. Completely different concept at all.
Okay, cool. So this is what our graphs are. This is a real graph.
Yes, exactly. There we go. Thank you. Somebody who understands.
Okay.
And then the question is, which graphs can you draw? So this is a plane. A piece of paper is a plane. And the question is, which graphs can you draw in the plane so that edges don't intersect? So what does it mean edges don't intersect? Don't intersect where they should. Like for example, in this graph, this edge and this edge, they intersect over here, but we meant it. They intersect over here because they have a common vertex over here. But for example, if I make this drawing, so the vertices are 1, 2, 3, 4, the edges are 1, 2, 3, this edge and that edge, they intersect and it's not a fair intersection. They just intersect because I drew it like this. I could have drawn it like that. So a graph is planar if you can draw it in the plane or on a piece of paper in such a way that two edges only intersect where you intended them to intersect, only intersect at the vertex.
Professor, if you draw a graph and edges intersect, does that mean it's not a graph or it's invalid or it's like breaking the rules, or is it just a different kind of graph?
It's a different kind of graph. It's so a graph, this is a graph and this is a graph. It's called an abstract graph. And then you can talk about a planar embedding of a graph. And what that means is that you've drawn it like this. This is a graph, but not a planar embedding. This is only illegal if what you're after is planar embedding.
Is a planar embedding somehow better?
It's probably possibly good for some applications, like if you want a VLSI component or something, which I don't know anything about. But it's just another property, right? In math, what do? We think of an object, we think of a property, and then we say, do all these objects have this property? Do some of these objects have this property? Can you tell if you have this property, what other property do you have? Can you characterize when you have this property? So being planar is a property some graphs have and some graphs don't have. And I actually haven't told you what planar means yet, I think. I told you what a planar embedding is, but I haven't told you what a planar graph is.
Okay.
So a graph is planar if it has a planar embedding. For example, this graph has a planar embedding, namely that one. This graph also has a planar embedding, namely this one. This graph, no matter how hard you try, does not have a planar embedding.
You couldn't cheat or manipulate and move
that the That is exactly right. That is exactly what it means. Here's an example that looks almost as complicated as that, right? This only differ from that by one vertex. Mm-hmm. But this you could actually embed in the plane, because what you do is you certainly number the vertices so that you believe me it's an embedding. And then you do this, right? So let me maybe explain why this is the same as that. What do we care about? We care about vertices and we care about which pairs of vertices are adjacent. So vertices are 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, that's fair. Now here, every pair is adjacent. So let's check that also here, every pair is adjacent. 1's adjacent to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 1, 4 is adjacent to them all. So this abstract graph is the same as that abstract graph. This is a planar embedding. This is not a planar embedding.
Do edges have to be straight? Like, could you have kept these vertices in the same places and like drawn curved lines around the place as well? Or
edges don't have to be straight. There are theorems that say that anything you can embed with curved edges, you can embed with straight edges. It doesn't matter. So you're asking me, could I leave these four vertices in place and just make the edges? Yes. So what I would do is, so I could make this completely asymmetric, ugly drawing, or this beautiful drawing.
Yeah, it's less elegant. Okay.
But on the other hand, this you can see how to get it, which yeah. I think has a lot of value.
So it's not a conjecture. It's a theorem that any planar graph that you can draw with curved edges, you could also have done with straight edges.
That's right.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, it is amazing, right?
Yeah.
I learned this theorem in the right time in my life. I was in high school when I heard about it. So I am, in fact, as amazed by this theorem as one should be. I haven't, become jaded by the time I heard of it.
But you can't do any trickery with that,
nope.
Like you did
no
there.
Trickery.
That one's...
No trickery. There is one more way you can do any trickery. And in fact, that's usually how introduction to planar graphs is taught. So you have three houses and three utilities.
Those houses are actual houses, they're not these houses.
I don't know, you tell me.
Okay.
No way to tell. You want to put lines between the utilities and the houses, right? You want to put power lines and phone lines and water pipes. And it's important that they don't intersect each other so that you can fix them independently or some other story along these lines. And so the question is, can you? And so, you know, you can try, you can maybe connect this one like that. So you got the electricity and you can connect the phone. Maybe you can go here, maybe you can go there, and maybe you can go there. And you can start with the water, but you're not going to be able to finish. And it's a theorem that you're not going to be able to finish. So if I draw this as a graph, everybody on the first side is adjacent to everybody on the second side. And this is called K33. By the way, this guy is called K5. So K5 and K33 are two graphs that do not have planar embeddings. They're the two smallest graphs that don't have planar embeddings. K, somewhat mystifyingly, stands for complete. And so this is a complete graph on five vertices. Now, this is not the complete graph, because obviously there are some pairs that are non-adjacent. You have two sides, this side and that side, and everybody on this side is adjacent to everybody on that side. That's called the complete bipartite graph. And the way we know that it's complete bipartite and not complete is because we have two numbers instead of one number. So KAB is A here, B there, all adjacent to each other. KT is T, all pairwise adjacent.
Is there a way to tell what's embeddable and what's not?
So there is a way to tell. And actually, it's a lovely theorem. It's a theorem I can tell you. You believe me that we can't embed those. In fact, maybe you shouldn't believe me, but there is an elegant proof of it. You need to know a little bit of geometry. You need to know something called Euler's formula. And from that, it's actually very easy to see that these two graphs are not embeddable. But let's say we believe that they're not embeddable. So then here's another graph that's not embeddable. If I take an edge here, and I what we call subdivide it, which means I'll draw some vertices in the middle. That's another graph that's not embeddable, right? Because if I could embed this, now just delete the vertices. And so and you can do that for any edge you like here, you can do it there. So these are all not embeddable. And they're called subdivisions. So we know that K5 is not embeddable, K3 is not embeddable, and we also convinced ourselves that subdivisions of them, they're all not embeddable. And the theorem is, that's it. The only reason some graph is not embeddable is because there is one of those bad guys sitting in it. You can delete vertices and edges from it and find either a subdivision of K33 or a subdivision of K5. It's called Kuratowski's theorem.
Just those two?
Just those two. It's a miracle.
So they're like the two spanners in the works.
Exactly. So the theorem is G is planar if and only if G has no K5 subdivision and no K33.
Wow. So every single graph, if I drew you the most complicated graph in the world and it was non-embeddable, you'd be able to find that in there somewhere.
That's right. That is correct. That's the only reason something is not embeddable. So these graphs are very special. Most graphs are not like that. It's a very special kind of graphs that are embeddable. It's not that other graphs are bad. Other graphs are good. In fact, most of the work is with other graphs.
Right.
It's just if you work with those, you can suddenly prove much stronger theorems. It's like, you know, you can think of all numbers or you can think of powers of two.
Or prime numbers.
Powers of two are much nicer than all numbers. It's not that other numbers are not good. It's just, you know, in some ways other numbers are more interesting because they're not powers of two. But there are certain theorems you can only prove about powers of two. So probably the most famous theorem about planar graphs is that you can color them with four colors. So maybe I'll talk about that a little bit. So coloring graph means you want to color the vertices so that adjacent vertices get different colors. So for example, in this graph, I can color this blue and this green, and also this green, this red, and make this blue, and this is a coloring. This is a coloring with three colors. So adjacent pairs get different colors. This is coloring with three colors. And you can see that you couldn't do it with fewer colors than three because you have these three vertices all pairwise adjacent. So you have to use three. And now the question is, if I give you a graph, what's the smallest number of colors you can use to color it? So one thing you immediately notice is that if you have a bunch of vertices all pairwise adjacent, then you need at least that many colors. In fact, sometimes you need many more. This is a whole different branch of math that's very active at the moment, but often you need many more, but at least this is an obvious lower bound. Now, in planar graphs, we know that we don't have a K5. So you're not going to have 5 vertices all pairwise adjacent. So at least this naive bound only would give you that you need 4. And the theorem is 4 is enough. The theorem is, it's called the 4-color theorem. Every planar graph is 4-colorable. It comes from map coloring. It was actually conjectured by a cartographer in 1863, I think, where he said, if I have a map and I want to color the countries so that adjacent countries get different colors, how many colors do I need? I seem to be noticing that 4 is always enough. And the answer is yes, 4 is always enough, because you can easily translate coloring a map into coloring a planar graph. What you do is take a map, right? So the countries are this outside ring and then those triangles. So now I'm going to make a graph out of it. I'm going to put a vertex in the middle of each country. If two countries share the border, I'm going to put an edge between the two vertices. Another way to think about it, I'm kind of turning the edges, right? This edge used to go like this between these two countries, but now I'm going to put it perpendicularly. So because this is a mess, let me just draw the blue graph again. So this is already better, but now I can draw it even better. I can do that. So anyway, so the black thing there was a map. The blue thing here is a planar graph. If I color the vertices of this planar graph, and then I use these colors to color the regions of this map, the countries of this map, it's the same problem. And so now the theorem is that it's enough to use 4 colors. For all of this to be true, you need some slightly technical assumptions. Like in this map, you can't have Alaska. The countries have to be contiguous, or as in math we say, connected. Because it's very easy to construct a map where each country is 100 islands and you need 100 colors to color it. But that's not what we mean. What we mean is we only all countries are connected.
With the planar embedding, if there was a really complicated graph here on the board, could you look at it and apply some algorithm or rule to be able to...
So you must be minded, I just wanted to talk about that.
Okay. Do you need more paper?
So I don't want to talk to you about an algorithm, but I'm going to talk to you about how to tell that something is not embeddable, or one way to tell that something is not embeddable, right? So I said K5 is not embeddable, and I say, just trust me, because it's hard to prove. But actually, if there's just one fact I tell you, then it's going to be easy to prove. And the fact is, the theorem is, in a planar graph, so let G be a planar graph, and then we have V is the number of vertices, and E is the number of edges. Then E is at most 3V minus 6. So now let's check that this guy fails, because it has 5 vertices, right? And the number of edges, so all pairs of 5 vertices, that's 10 edges. And now you can see that 10 is not less or equal than 3 times 5 minus 6. So this is for sure not planar. So now, armed with this wisdom, you want to prove that this is not planar.
Our electricity, water, telephone one.
So let's count. The number of vertices is 6. The number of edges is 9. And then if you do that, it does come out, sadly. 9 is at most 3 times 6 minus 6, so that's not going to work. Right? This is not an if and only, this is just a tool. But in fact, you can look at the proof of this theorem more closely, and you'll find out that if your graph doesn't have cycles of length 3, then you can improve this.
So there's another test.
Yes. Yeah. G is not planar and G has no triangle, then E is at most 2V minus 4.
All right.
And then, so first of all, let's check that this is going to be helpful. So E is 9, 2 times 6 minus 4 is not at least 9. That's a good start. Now we just need to convince ourselves that we can use this theorem to test this graph. So what do I need to check? I need to check that this doesn't have triangles. But if you think about this for a minute, this graph has a property that the vertices come in 2 flavors, and all the edges, and the only edges you have go between them. Look at a cycle, start looking at it at this vertex, it's gonna go right, left, right, left, right, left, and eventually it has to come back. So it's gonna have an even number of vertices. So in particular, it doesn't have triangles. So now you might ask, well, you know, this worked very well to test. Maybe it's true the other way. If I give you a graph and I promise, I mean, somehow it makes sense, right? If I give you a bunch of vertices And in order to embed it, you need that there aren't too many edges, right? If there's too many edges, it's too much of a mess, you can't embed it. And maybe it's true that if I give you a graph has a bunch of vertices and there are not too many edges, then you can embed it. Yeah. But that doesn't work, unfortunately. So false, E small as a function of V implies planar.
But you'd think it would be easier if there were fewer edges, like, or is that not the case?
Well, so let me show you an example and you tell me if it's easier or harder. Start with a K5, which we know is a bad guy. And now draw lots and lots and lots of vertices, just they're called isolated vertices that start no edges. So this has a million billion gazillion vertices and 10 edges, and you can't embed it because it's got this K5 that you'll have to embed. And you can say, well, this is just a cheat and disconnected graphs, but make it connected. Put maybe, it's called a pass, put a thing like this that goes through all of these vertices.
I would argue that's still a bit of a cheat, but all right.
I mean, there's maybe a way to make it sufficiently connected. And
if you'd like to watch even more from this interview, where we go into the professor's work on so-called perfect graphs, then we've put that over on Numberphile 2, our second channel. There'll be links on the screen and down in the video description.